If it's your first time here or if you're visiting, we are so thrilled that you have chosen to worship with us this morning. And we pray that you will feel the presence of the Lord here as we meet. Stand up and praise the Lord, our God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be his... I meant stand up. You were on. You. I saw you. Stand up. I'll start again. Stand up and praise the Lord, our God, who is from everlasting to everlasting. Blessed be his glorious name, and may it be exalted above all blessing and praise.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord, we will wait upon the Lord. Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. Wait upon the Lord.
We will wait upon the Lord.
Our God, you reign forever. Strong deliverer.
You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles.
Our God, you reign forever. Our hope, our strong deliverer.
You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint, you won't grow weary. You're the defender of the weak. You comfort those in need. You lift us up on wings like eagles. You are the everlasting God. The everlasting God. You do not faint. On wings like eagles.
Praise the Lord. Just give your applause to him. Praise his holy name. Our God, the words of that song, aren't they amazing? He is the defender of the weak. He comforts those in need. And he lifts us up on wings like eagles. He is the name above all names, worthy of all praise. How great is our God. Sing with me, how great is our God.
Rejoice, all the earth rejoice.
at his voice and trembles at his voice. How great is the God? Sing with me, how great is the God? And I will see how great is the God. And age to age he stands, and time is in his hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son, the Lion and the Lamb.
After that, but you may be seated.
Well, how great is our God?
Very Amen.
Very great. Thank you, Luca. Or was that you? That was you. Thank you. How great is our God?
Very great.
All right. Look at the person beside you and say, it's great to have you here this morning. Okay. And there's no lying when you're saying that, right? Right. How great is this band this morning? Yes, give them. Yes, give them an applause for sure. It's a very young band. They've only been functioning for, I believe, 4 years. Dave, stand up there.
4 years.
4 years? Stand up so everybody recognizes. This is Dave Hamilton. He is the conductor, and he's done a remarkable job, and we've had a nice association with them, with the band, and it's been really good. The association is not because of me. The association is because we have 5 Salvationists in the band. We have Doug, and we have Philip, and we have Carol, and we have Rick, and we have Mike, who travels all the way up from the big city. So it's really nice. They've been around part of the Kawartha Lakes within an hour and a half drive. So that just shows you the expanse that some of them, I believe some even come from a community called Keene as well. Isn't that great? The guest conductor this morning is Alan Moss, who is a Salvationist from the South. And it's nice to have Alan a part of that. He's giving me a break. I get a holiday on a Sunday. How good is that? I'm glad you're here, my friend. I'm glad you're here. Alan. Alan originally hails from St. Louis. He now lives in Melbourne, Florida. He has been a bandmaster for in banding for 50 years or more. And he went to what they call, what would be our version of National School of Music up here in Chicago with William Hines. So all you bandsmen would know who William Hines was. They went there together as teenagers, and that's where I guess the Lord continued to endow them with the special ability, not only to play, but to compose. And Alan has composed some songs that they're going to be singing, that the band is playing probably for the first time, as far as the contemporary worship songs go today. So it's really nice to have them with us. So give them an applause again, will you? Now, I'm doing my Sergeant Major's role right now, and that's to give the announcements, and I hope I don't muck them up. He'll be on duty next week. September the 3rd. These are anniversaries. September the 3rd, Mal and Doris. Wave your hands, Mal. Okay, there he is. And Doris, is she here? Where's Doris? Oh, my little sweetie back there. I see ya. 60 years together on September the 3rd. Beautiful. They had a great day celebrating the on the 22nd, and a lot of people came through to share in their excitement for this day. Birthdays coming up before we go on, while we're away on holidays. Emma on the 4th, June Carr and Elliot on the 6th, and Care Roll on the 7th. Messy Church and Back to Church Sunday is going to be on Tuesday, September the 15th at 5 o'clock, and it's going to be an activity of outdoor stuff going on here, barbecues, castles, petting zoo, yeah, all those kinds of things, sponge throws at your favorite person, and all those things, and we hope that you'll come and share. Mark your calendar, Tuesday, September 15th, 5 o'clock start here in the parking lot, and pray that it's going to be good weather. Thursday, September the 24th, 7:30. Seven. Do You Believe? It's the next movie that we're going to be sharing here. It's just coming out. It's supposed to be a really good movie. If you saw God's Not Dead, you're really going to enjoy this one. So come out September the 24th at 7 o'clock. And that's being hosted by 100.3 Life FM. Right? Woohoo! I'm on a roll. And I think that's it. So let's have the ushers. They're ready to go. Let's just pray together, shall we? God, our Father, we are so excited about this day, your day, a day set aside to come and to worship you, and we just thank you for giving us the opportunity and the freedom that we have in our great country to come together on a Sunday and to worship in this way. We thank you, our Father, for the Northern Spirit Big Band, and we thank you for the leadership that Alan is going to present to us today and the message that they're going to give us. Keep our heart's door open to the speaking of your word. Help us to sing songs of praise that just bring adoration to you and bless all that we do. Use our offering this day. To expand your kingdom here on earth through the programs that we establish. Father, we give you all praise this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. One, two, three.
Reading from Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, verse 1. The words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem. Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher. Utterly meaningless. Everything is meaningless. What does man gain from all his labor at which he toils under the sun? I, the teacher, at verse 12, I, the teacher, was king over Israel in Jerusalem. I devoted myself to study and to explore by wisdom all that is done under heaven. What a heavy burden God has laid on men. I have seen all the things that are done under the sun. All of them are meaningless, a chasing after the wind. What is twisted cannot be straightened. What is lacking cannot be counted. I thought to myself, look, I have grown and increased in wisdom more than anyone who has ruled over Jerusalem before me. I have experienced much of wisdom and knowledge. Then I applied myself to the understanding of wisdom and also of madness and folly, but I learned that this, too, is a chasing after the wind.
I was a king of a great nation, favored by God. God had gifted me magnanimously, given me my heart's desire. Sadly, though, I didn't always follow God's teachings. You may know what that's like. There came a time in my life when despair was my closest companion, misery my best friend. I searched high and low for meaning in this world. I looked for it in arts and culture, in feats of athleticism. I searched for it in all I built, in my family, my children. I could find no meaning. I didn't spend days, weeks. I spent years trying to find meaning in this world. Finally, I concluded, there is no meaning in this world whatsoever. I turned to the Lord. I said, Lord, I can find no meaning. And then it struck me. God, my God, who had cared for me all my life, and I was searching for meaning elsewhere. God was all the meaning I could ever want. Solomon's been gone for many years now. His world was way different than ours. Hand to mouth was how people lived in those days. Nowadays, here in Canada, our greatest challenge is how to fill our leisure hours. Perhaps the search for meaning nowadays would be even more difficult. No words I'll say, nothing that can happen here or even out there will ever bring anyone to Christ or know God. That takes a personal encounter with God. The words of Solomon, the beginning of knowledge is the fear of the Lord. Shall we pray? Father God, my brothers and sisters who are gathered here with me today can know the wisdom of Solomon by embracing God, doing his will, and seeking him first in our lives. I pray, dear Lord, that you would take this message and make it real in our hearts and spread it throughout the world. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
As Christians, we hear the Easter story right from the time we are young children. And I think we often lose sight of the power and the meaning of the cross and its significance to us. We take it for granted. But if we really stop and think and meditate on it, we will be in awe of just how important the cross is and the incredible power in Jesus' selfless act of love. His death on the cross. His death means life. Life for you and for me. If we accept his death as payment for our sins, which reconciles us with God, paving the way for us to have a personal relationship with him, just as we just heard. What a love. What a cost. Do you stand forgiven? us.
To see the dawn of the darkest day, Christ on the road to Calvary, tried by sinful men, torn and beaten then, nailed to a cross of wood. This the power of the cross. Christ became sin for us, took the blame, bore the wrath we stand for. Became
thank you, Lord, for the power of the cross. May we stand forgiven at the cross. The next song is by a Salvationist, Joy Webb, and it tells how that when we're going through difficult times, God says to us, share my yoke and find that I am joined with you. Your slightest movement I feel, and I'll be there too. Share my yoke and come the way that I must go. In our togetherness with God, my peace you'll know, and the world beholding us will see it so.
Just take a second to introduce to you Rob Snellgrove. He's all the way from Halliburton, drives to every rehearsal and every time this band plays. He serves the same Lord that you and I do.
Thank you.
In Matthew 7, we read, enter through the narrow gate. These are instructions. We need to pay attention. For wide is the gate and broad the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it. Our next song says, there's a path that's sometimes thorny. There's a narrow way and straight. It is called the path of duty, and it leads to heaven's gate. I've heard it said that the song makes it sound like we can get to heaven by doing good things, which is not true. Because Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Jesus is the narrow road, the way to heaven. It is love for him and not good deeds which gets us to heaven. It is out of love for him that we choose to do good things. But not just feeling of love. Otherwise, what happens when we're having a bad day, tragedy strikes, and when you don't feel especially Christian? What holds us to our faith and causes us to do good anyway? It may not be duty, but rather discipline. The pathway of discipline might not be the actual word of the song, but it works without changing the meaning of the song. When we don't feel like serving God, it is discipline that keeps us going. Fasting, meditation, study of God's word, and prayer and worship are ways of drawing closer to him. When we are close to God, we can serve him even on the days when we don't feel like it. Discipline matters. It enables us to be much more accurate reflections of Jesus. And the beautiful thing is that this discipline is not generated from ourselves. It is given by God's Holy Spirit. While we tread this path of duty, we will find our needs supplied from the river of God's mercy that is flowing close beside.
There's a path that's sometimes thorny. There's a narrow way and straight. It is called the path of duty, and it leads to heaven's gate. While we tread this path of duty, we will find our needs supplied from the river of God's mercy that is flowing close beside. By the pathway of duty flows the river of God's grace. By the pathway of duty flows the river of God's grace. 'Tis a blessed way and holy, 'tis a path of peace and joy. Though sometimes the way be stony and the cares of life annoy, by this path that we call duty is the way the Master trod. And a smile of love and beauty lights the way that leads to God. By the pathway, please stand, duty flows a river of God's grace. By the pathway of duty flows a river. Let us walk this path of duty with our faces to the sun. Carry all our burdens gladly, finish well what we've begun. From the river of God's mercy that is flowing by the way, we may drink and find refreshing for the the river of God's grace. By the pathway of duty flows the river of God's grace. By the pathway of duty flows the river of God's grace. By the pathway of duty flows the river of God's grace.
We never sang it like that when I was a kid. Thank you, Alan, for that arrangement. That was really great. Lots of life in that one. So if you are feeling, please stay on your feet. We got another lively one coming. and then you'll get to sit again. I was going to say something about it being lively. Anyway, Galatians 2 and 20 reads,
Okay, this is a jazz band. You know, Salvation Army folks like to clap on the beat. We clap off the beat. So follow my lead, it'll work.
When I was a kid, someone taught me at music camp about clapping off the beat, Ellen, and I thought I was really cool when I did. I didn't know it was a jazz thing. I guess it was in me from way back. Galatians 2 and 20 reads, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So the life I now live in the body, I live because of the faithfulness of the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. I pray that this is your testimony today. He is our strength and our hope.
It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. It is no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. He lives, he lives. Jesus is alive in me. Hallelujah, for it's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. It's no longer I that no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me. He lives, he lives. Jesus is alive in me. It's no longer I that liveth, but Christ that liveth in me.
Children may leave to go to their classes. Their classes are so good. The Lord meets with them there. We pray for that every week, so that's why the enthusiasm.
This book.
How many do, for sure? Would you put your life on it? It's not just a book, is it? It's not just words. It's the anointed word of God. It's what he gave to us through some writers, true enough. Well, Jesus had surprising ways many times of answering people. There was 5,000 people. By the way, my daughter has stood on the spot he stood on when he preached to 5,000 people. And they were hungry, and they didn't know what to eat. And the disciples were getting worried about it. And they went to him, and they said, listen, we're going to have to let these people go. And he said, well, isn't there anybody? And he asked, and you know the rest of the story, a boy with some loaves and fishes, and you know the miracle that he did and fed 5,000 and have 12 baskets left over. He would always do things beyond anybody's expectation. Well, there was another time when he was preaching to a bunch of people, and Jesus' mother and brothers came to see him, but they were not able to get near him because of the crowd. Someone told him, your mothers and brothers are standing outside wanting to see you. And he looked at someone and said, my mothers and brothers are those who serve and believe in the Word of God. They didn't expect to hear that, that's for sure. And the actual words were, my mother and brothers are those who hear God's word and put it into practice. Well, how do we put it into practice? We come to church. A friend of mine, a wonderful Christian friend, he says, you know, if you go into any church, what you'll see people who go to church. And isn't that true? But there's a world out there, and in the 1800s, a pastor by the name of William Booth saw that world. He said, how can we reach them? They won't come in, we'll have to go out. And he did. Not into churches, he went into a bar. He went in the street corners. And he preached this word. I don't have to tell you what happened. In 2011, I was getting old. I'm there now. And what I've wanted to do all my life is something that would impact or reach people who don't go to church. If any of you know a little bit of my history, I was very involved in a ministry to teenagers on board a ship on Lake Ontario. Ann Clark is over there. She was there. And some of you may be aware of it. Just learned that one of our members here, our bass player, played on the Heaven Bound. The purpose? Reach people who don't go to church. We had 500 of them in the years that all together, 300 saved. Every once in a while I run into one of them. In the middle of nowhere, a guy phoned me and he says, I was in Mombasa. I saw two of your t-shirts walking down the street. Well, that's the purpose of this band. I'm praying that God will use this band as another tool to reach the people who don't go to church. And if he would give us the honor of being part of planting a seed of thought or curiosity or wonder that would lead towards going to church, we've done our job. Pray for us. If you want to pray hard, come to Fairhaven tonight. Come to Fairhaven Camp, because those people are going to get the shock of their life. It's a very evangelical camp, and we're going to take music in there that the people who don't go to church know, and they don't. But the people who don't go to church are coming, being invited, neighbors, friends, relatives, loved ones are being invited because they're using the term big band as a drawing card. That's what Northern Spirit's all about. Pray for us. Thank you.
You may just want to bow in prayer as the band plays the Lord's Prayer.
Thank you.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for all you have done for us. Be with us today. Be with us as we go into this time of our meeting, the time of sharing. Put me behind the cross. I don't want them to see me. I want to see them to see you and your spirit. We pray. Amen. Boy, what a group. Isn't that something? All right, let's give them a hand. Yeah. What a thrill for me. I sit at my computer and I dream up these things in music and I bring them here and these guys just do it. They just make things happen. What's interesting about the group is how varied they are. They represent lots of churches, lots of places all over your community, and it's really neat to be a part of it. But I've had some really serious problems here in your area. My cell phone is not working. Apparently, the company that I'm with in the States is hooked up with the Rogers system, and I don't want to say anything bad about Rogers, but it doesn't work. And yeah, you can applaud that. And the problem, and I think the major problem is that I haven't I don't have my son or my daughter here to show me how to make this thing work. Isn't it amazing? You know, we raise up our children. I'm trying to turn the sound off so that we don't have it interrupting me. No, I went on silent mode. Okay, I learned that from my son. Okay, it's amazing. You know, we raise our children up and we know where they're going. We've been there. We've done that. We want to teach them all the way. But when we really want to learn about the newest things, who do we go to? You know? Sometimes, you know, I've heard people say that these things are just absolutely, you know, why do we have all this new technology? And I can tell you exactly why we have new technology. It's because it makes you communicate with your children. Well, you believe me. You've done that. How many have done that? Yeah, a lot of folks. Okay, well, that's not where we're at. We're going to go to the scriptures. And one of the things that I found under your chairs is pew Bibles. And if you have a pew Bible, it's on page 1105. It's 1 Corinthians. We're going to go there, and we're going to take a look at a little bit of 1 Corinthians. I'll give you a minute to find it. Again, it's page 1105 in your book. I do believe it's 1 Corinthians. I know it is. First Corinthians, first chapter, verse 17. And I've been doing most of my study out of the King James. That's one of the things that I do is I go to the King James a lot just to get that view. And then I'll go to the Bible you have in your pew and we'll look it up. And of course, I didn't get it keyed up in this Bible. Oh, come on. Come on. Here we go. Verse 17, I believe. Yes, verse 17. For Christ did not send me to baptize. This is Paul. Christ did not send me to baptize, but to preach the gospel, not with words of human wisdom, lest the cross of Christ be emptied of its power. And I'd like to rephrase that a little bit. I was not sent here to perform a concert for you guys. I was not here to work and do all this music stuff. That's not why I was here. That's not why I'm here. I am here to preach the gospel, but not with words, not with music. I'm not preaching the gospel with music. I'm not preaching the gospel with words, but I'm preaching the gospel with Christ, the cross of Christ. And one of the things David was talking about a while ago was church, getting people to go to church. Well, I don't necessarily agree with that. You see, I think, you know, we can get all these people to go to church, but if they haven't got Christ in their hearts, they don't need to be there, right? Okay, I maybe I said that wrong. Maybe it was a little sideways, but it's going to church is good. I really believe we need to do that. We need to be amongst the body of believers, but we have to have Christ in our hearts. We have to take Christ with us. And when we leave, we have to take Christ with us.
When we're there, we're taking being with Christ. A while ago, we were worshiping through music, and it wasn't the music we were worshiping. Duh. No, we were not worshiping music. We were worshiping Jesus Christ. We got to get that through our heads. It's not the music that we worship. It's not the Salvation Army we worship. It's not the church we go to. It's not the major. It's not the captains. It's not anybody. We are here to worship Jesus Christ, period, nothing else. When we get astray, when we start thinking that other things are more important, that's where we fall into difficulty. And that's what Paul is talking about here. He said, I don't care. I'd rather not have baptized anybody. What I'm here to do is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's not with words. It's not flowery words. It's not signs and wonders. It's just the gospel of Jesus Christ. You see, that's what William Booth did. William Booth used lots of different ways to get people to come in. But when he got in, it was the gospel of Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And if we lose our primary purpose in our church, in our core, in our anywhere we're at, in our daily living, then if we lose that primary purpose, then we are as tinkling brass and sounding cymbals. We are nothing. Okay. It's 18th verse. For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing. You know, the people who are perishing that don't believe, we talk to them about the cross, and to them it's just so much foolishness. They don't believe. But to us who are being saved, it is the cross that Jesus Christ died on. It's not just the cross. It's Jesus Christ is the power of God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate. It says in the 20th verse, where is the wise man? Where is the scholar? Where is the philosopher of this age? Has not God made foolishness the wisdom of the world? Most of the things that we think are really, really smart are just foolishness. Sometimes I think this thing is God. It beats me up all the time. It wins. I try to make it do things, it doesn't work. I take it to my son, he says, oh, you do this. And I go, oh. And it's, my daughter's even worse than he is, and she's younger, but she rubs it in. let's see, for since the wisdom, I think 22nd verse. Jews demand miraculous signs. I like this. Jews demand miraculous signs, and Greeks look for wisdom. Now, that's what it says in the Bible, because, see, Paul is talking to Jews and he's talking to Greeks. But here we can say Canadians demand miraculous signs and people from America look for wisdom, or vice versa, or one neighbor looks for signs and the other one looks for wisdom. All he uses those is because that's what they were accustomed to. But in the 23rd verse it says, but we preach Christ crucified. Now, Christ being crucified is a stumbling block to the Jews, is what I read here. And it's, if people don't get Christ on the cross, it's a stumbling block. They don't get it. And it is foolishness to the Gentiles, but to those of us who God has called, both whether or not you're a Jew or a Greek or where you're from, that's what it says, both Jews and Greeks. Doesn't make any difference where you're from. If you have called, if you've got Christ in your heart, Christ, the power of God, is the wisdom of God. For the foolishness of God is wiser than man's wisdom, and the weakness of God is stronger than man's strength. Brothers, think of what you were when you were called. Oh, I'd like to talk about that. Brothers, think of you when you were called. There was... we had a gentleman that came up here, and he was talking about the part of his life where he was in total despair. I've been there. I know what it's like to be in the gutter. I know what it's like to be beaten down. I know what it's like to have everybody look at you and laugh at you. I've been there. But when I was called, I was beaten down, and I was raised up because of the power of Jesus Christ, not because of anything that I could do, because I'm powerless. The only power comes from the Lord Jesus Christ. That's where our strength comes from. And I'm going to repeat that over and over and over again because I don't think we get it enough. You know, I don't think we can get it enough. We often think that our car is more powerful, our wife is more powerful, our husband, money is more powerful. We put all these gods in front of us, and the only God that we need to be worshiping is the Lord Jesus Christ, period. Period. None other. So it says, brothers, think of what you were when you were called. I'm going to look at these guys over here, and I say, you know, when you first picked up your horn, what did you think of the horn? It was like you couldn't play Twinkle Twinkle Little Star, Mary Had a Little Lamb. Somebody showed you how to honk on that thing, right? Remember where you came from? All right. And then gradually, over a period of time, things changed. Your eyes started opening up. You started going toward the direction of actually being a musician. Now, are we wise by human standards? Even today, I can look at this group over here and I can tell you, I know most of them well enough to tell you that there's not one of them that think they have arrived. Not one of them think they really, really have conquered the ability to play those instruments. They are a work in progress. Every one of them plays to their best ability, but it's not as, there's not one of them here that's playing as good as they want to play. Am I right?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah, we don't, nobody knows or is playing to the best of their ability. And in our Christian walk, it's exactly the same way. There's not a Christian, I don't believe there's a Christian that believes he's arrived. Not one of us is Christ. Not one of us is perfect. We are all works in progress. And so often, we judge people by what we think a Christian should be. Oh, that person couldn't possibly be a Christian. And yet, they know Jesus Christ. They're just in a different part of their walk. Who are we to tell people that that person can't possibly be a Christian? Or the guy down the street that's going to another church, how could he possibly be a Christian? There's no way he can know about Christ. He doesn't go to our church. Oh, come on. Christ is available to all of us, whether we're Greek or Jews, Gentiles, from the United States, from where else is there in Canada that nobody would ever go to? Newfoundland. Go with me to the 12th chapter of Corinthians. Corinthians 12:12. I love this part of the Bible. I use it very often. You know, when I'm out and I'm sharing with people out in the community and we're talking, and I don't know how many times I've shared with these guys in the last couple of days about all of us being a part of the body of Christ. Not one of us is perfect, but every one of us is a part of the body of Christ. You know, the largest organ on a human body is skin. It's just skin. Skin is considered an organ, and it's a huge organ. It weighs, I don't know, how many pounds, depends upon how big you are. You know, but skin is a huge organ. How important is skin? Well, now, you know, people look at the body of the church and they see people who are playing horns or running a sound system or singing or preaching or even the custodian gets a higher reputation as far as working for the body of Christ than we think we are sometimes because who are we? We're just a nothing. You know, we're just maybe a little piece of skin or a hair or just that we're not really attuned to how important. But think of it. When you get a scratch, you fix it right now, don't you? You don't wait. You get a cut. You get a bruise. Oh, my, that's a big deal. That hurts. That's a part of the body of Christ. And when you're a part of the body of Christ and you get hurt, we need to go to that part and help heal them. Help give them... affirm them, lift them up, put a Band-Aid on it, do whatever we have to do, even if all it is a little scratch in the skin in the body of Christ. One of the things that happened, I was here in this area last year. I came up and worked with the band a little bit last year, not a lot, but a little bit, gave them some music, and it was great, a great good time. But when before I left, my mom had taken ill, and we'd taken her to the hospital, and she got out of the hospital, was at home, and had a nurse watching her, and I was here, got here like on Thursday, I think, and I called her every day to see how she was doing, even on my old Rogers phone. Called her every day and to see how she was doing. I called her on Monday, and she wasn't right. I could tell on the phone, thousands of miles away, that she wasn't right. I knew what her voice sounded like. It wasn't right. She was stressed, and we needed to find out what was wrong. So I talked to her a little longer, found out that she really wasn't feeling well. She was having a reaction to some medicine. And so I couldn't fly out of here. It's like, once you get here, you're a prisoner. A prisoner for David Howard. Anyway, you know, he's not Jesus Christ, but I was a prisoner here. I really had work that needed to be done. I was up here not just for this area, but another as well, and had opportunities to share my witness with these other folks. But I was here for a reason. Mom knew that I was here for a reason. She wanted me here. Anyway, the family finally got an ambulance that came and picked her up, and I was up here. She was way down there. Took her to the hospital, induced a coma, and I never saw her again. When I got back, we pulled the plug and she died. You know, and to be long distance away, and she lived right there with us, you know, and it's like, oh, how sad. And yet, I knew where I was supposed to be. She wanted me here. You know, see, she's a Christian. You know, she's a Salvationist, had been a Salvationist of a really good standing for longer than I've been alive. And she's just a good, solid, sound soldier of the cross. And my mom's promoted to glory. I mean, hello. You know, I'm not going to be sad about that. You know, it just, to me, it was a really great thing. And one of the things we did at my mom's funeral was we played When We All Get to Heaven, very similar to what we just did here for your offertory. Because when we all get to heaven, what a day of rejoicing that will be. And it really is a day of rejoicing. We had the happiest funeral you could ever imagine. And went to her place, the home where she was staying, and did a service for them there. Did exactly this song there. And the people were like, there was people that knew her that were, you know, she was doing all kinds of work for the Lord, going to the hospitals, visiting the sick, right up to the 2 days before she was promoted to glory. She was doing stuff for work right up to the end. So at her funeral, and I'd like to share this because I think this applies to what I'm talking about today. At her funeral, I got up to the platform and said, you know, my mother was the elbow. And everybody laughed. My mother was the elbow. Well, what do you mean? How's your mother an elbow? Well, first of all, my mother was a part of the body of Christ, number one. Okay? She was the elbow in the body of Christ. Was she a hand? No, she was not the person that was out in front doing those things. Was she the eyes? No, she was behind the scenes. Now, if you take an opportunity, go look and take a look at your elbow. You can't see it. You can't see the elbow. And that's the way my mom was. She was behind the scenes. You can't see the elbow. It's there. When it gets hurt, you know it's hurt. You know, and if you don't have an elbow and you're trying to brush your teeth, just try to... It doesn't work. It takes an elbow to do those kinds of things. The hand is much less useful if the elbow isn't there to make it work. The kind of work Mom did was she visited people in the hospitals, but she had great handwriting. She had the most beautiful script. So she would write out the invitations and the things for our big services and our big meetings, and she'd spend hours doing calligraphy for the things, the special things the Salvation Army did. And then when it was time to do the Christmas, the people would come in and we would need to sign them up for the Christmas effort. She'd be there and she'd be working day after day after day, writing down their names and numbers and making sure that we got the right people in the right spot, got their ages and all those things. And it takes people that do all of those things. Now, the reason I'm going this direction is because not everybody is going to play a horn. Not everybody's going to be a preacher. Not everybody's going to do all this, but we all are a part of the body of Christ, and we all have to do our job. Now, we have a young lady back here who plays last year trumpet, And she says, well, I'm just, you know, I'm a nothing back there. But I tell you what, she is 25% of that whole section right there. She's very, very important. You know, it's nice to have three guys up here that can play nice and loud, but without her there to hold them up and keep them, actually keep them under control. she does a wonderful job, but it's everybody in the band. And even though they may not feel like they're the strongest player, they are the, everyone is equally important in the eyes of Christ, and we need to keep that forward. And I'd like to do one last scripture, and we're going to go quick here because I know you guys are interested in hearing the rest of the program, but the service. But it's I think this is too important. Psalms 150. If you put your thumb right in the middle of the Bible, you'll find Psalms. Go to the last Psalms. It's 150. And it's Psalms about praise the Lord, it says. Praise God in His sanctuary. Praise Him in His mighty heavens. Praise Him for His acts of power. Praise Him for His surpassing greatness. Praise Him with the sounding of the trumpet. Praise Him with the harp and the lyre. Praise Him with the tambourine and dancing. Praise Him with the strings and the flute. We even have a flute here. Praise Him with the clash of cymbals back here, and praise Him with the resounding cymbals. That's the real big cymbals. And let everything that have breath praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That psalm is not about musical instruments. No. That psalm starts off with the words, praise the Lord. It ends with praise the Lord. It's telling us that whether we're doing this or doing that, or doing something else, whatever, we have breath. Praise ye the Lord.
Praise the Lord. Let us come before the Lord in an attitude of prayer. Let us wait upon Him. Listen to His voice. What has He been saying to you this morning through the speakers, the songs, and the scripture? Let us wait for Him.
Let the mountains move. We come with expectation, waiting here for you.
Hands lifted high.
praise your holy name, Father. It is you we adore. We long to hear from you. And we want to do your will. We praise you for all you have done for us, for your amazing grace. In Jesus' name, we praise you. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Been waiting for this day, waiting to hear what Northern Spirit Big Band would have to offer to us. But the perspective has been for us today that we've really been waiting to see what God would have for us. And God has blessed us through them, and we want to express our deepest heartfelt thanks to Dave and to Alan and to the band members for making it possible to be here with us today. And so we give you thanks for that. Alan reminded us, it's not about us. It's not about the major. Darn.
Get over it.
But hey, I've always said all along, it's never been about me. And we are reminded through Scripture today in Paul's writing to the Corinthians of that. God alone made it possible for you, for me, for us to be in Jesus Christ. My prayer for you this morning, should anyone be here who is not walking that walk, that God would speak to you, that you would speak to one of us before you leave this place, so that you can go leaving with Jesus Christ in a relationship with you this morning. That is my deepest prayer. And I know it's the prayer of all who gather in the house of the Lord. Our chains are gone. We've been set free. And it's all because of Jesus Christ. And so, Father, we just thank you for this time of worship and fellowship and praise. It's all been done to bring glory and honor to you because you are our God. We are your people. And so we would pray that you would just continue to anoint us, continue to bless, and use us as instruments to bring the good news to a lost and dark world. Father, as we bring this meeting to a close in our closing song, we pray, send the fire. Amen.
Please stand.
Today we claim, send the fire today. Look down and see this waiting host, and send the promised Holy Ghost. We need another Pentecost. Send the fire today.
God of Elijah, hear our cry. Send the fire and make us fit to live or die.
Send the fire today to burn up every trace of sin, to bring the light of glory in. The revolution now begins. Send the fire today.